Yeah, I mean, there's a temptation to look at a situation as it now and think that the way things appear now is the way they've always have been. But if you go back even just 100 years, the demographics are very different, and go back 200 years and you see a much more pluralistic Middle East. The Christian and other communities, there was a much greater diversity. And so by kind of early 1900s, you had something like 20% of the region were Christian communities. And then to now what we see currently, the estimates are closer to 4% in that 100 years. But even to look at the scope and the pace at which that displacement is happening, the exodus of Christians from the Middle East, it's accelerating. That you look at the last 15 years, the communities of Iraq, those Christian communities going from 1.5 million down to now under 200,000, approaching 100,000, and even those that are still there are themselves internally displaced. Christians from Syria in the context of that conflict from 2011 to the present, and upwards of 400,000 that have been displaced either internally or across the region, and some that have been able to emigrate out of the region overall. So it's certainly something that we're looking at. You have, and this is a contested issue when you look at somewhere like Egypt or Lebanon, this idea of doing the census is delicate, both for the authorities' side, for the majority has reasons that they're hesitant of it, but even the communities themselves are worried about having good numbers on these statistics. But anecdotally, you're hearing of both the general insecurity is driving an emigration out of the region, as well as these questions about opportunity and whether there really is in the culture a pluralistic society that will allow for the flourishing of every citizen of the Middle East, whether that's an Egyptian Christian or an Egyptian Baha'i or an Egyptian Sunni Muslim. Can they flourish in Egypt? That same situation in Lebanon or Syria or Iraq. Those questions, there's not really an overwhelming positive answer, and that's causing many of, especially younger generations, to look at emigrating out of the region. I mean, that's very much something that we look at, as there's the principled argument of the value of religious freedom that's rooted in the dignity of the human person and the rights for that. And that's one argument we make. But another is really the practical, strategic benefits of religious freedom. And you see these correlations between greater religious freedom and a reduction in all kinds of violence, be that terrorism from outside. The incubation of domestic terrorism decreases when you have greater religious freedom. When you have blasphemy laws that are enforced, the likelihood of religion-related terrorism increases more than 6 times. And so making these strategic arguments to governments that if you want a stable and secure country, religious freedom will help you get there. On the economic side, this case can be made as well, that when you have more religious freedom, when you free up the human capital of all of your religious communities, your economy increases. When you restrict and constrain that, it drives that economic potential out of the region, and you see decreases in economic vitality as you see religious freedom being decreased as well. I think addressing this question of unity among, if we want to see pluralism happening across the community as a whole, for Christians, it needs to happen within the churches, that you have the in Iraq, the Chaldean Catholics and the Syriac Catholics and the Orthodox and even the Protestant and these other denominations that are banding together. And when they see, like the New Testament says, when they see one part of the bodies hurting, the other bodies hurt with them. And so that they're able to collectively, not to minimize differences over theology, but to really pursue the flourishing of one community, really has a powerful message to speak to the broader communities in the Middle East. And it's a challenge, and when you look at the situation and the threats that they're facing and the challenges of the pastoral care of these communities, the situation is difficult, but this is something that as Christians the gospel speaks to enable to building a united single body of Christ that's able to work together and care for the needs of each other. And that's something that we're trying to encourage among the communities.